half in the bag.
I bet my wife at the casino and won.
Everyone, I'm Mike.
And I'm Jay, and we're here in Daytona Beach for spring break 2012.
That's right, Jay. We're taking a break from fixing VCRs to bring you a very special episode of Half in the Bag, which is sponsored by Karpinski Funeral Homes, crossing the bridge together.
We're also sponsored by Quality Caskets, affordable prices, quality craftsmanship.
And McDonald's, I'm loving it.
Hey, Mike, before we hit up the beach, do you want to go see some movies?
Sure do, Jay. What a great way to spend 4 hours indoors when it's sunny and warm out.
What?
What movies would you like to see, Jay?
Let's go see A Million Ways to Die in the West, because of Family Guy, yo.
No, I heard that movie's terrible. Let's also see X-Men Days of Future Past.
Okay.
All right, let's go.
Okay.
He had to stand on a small box to be almost as tall as me.
So many battles waged over the years. And yet, none of them like this. Are we destined to destroy each other? Or can we change who we are and unite? Is the future truly set?
X-Men Days of Future Past marks the return of director Bryan Singer, a man who was recently accused of making two really good X-Men movies. In this fifth X-Men film, Wolverine travels back in time to stop a midget from making tall things. All the important X-Men characters are in it as Wolverine attempts to fix a future that really sucks for everyone. Except for dangerous tall things. And maybe the company that manufactures badass alternate future body armor. And maybe Ian McKellen, because he's still alive. So Jay, while we're out on this beautiful beach, on a beautiful day, let's talk about X-Men. Days of Future Pants. What did you think of X-Men?
Mike, let me tell you something. Okay, this is a superhero movie, and not a single fucking city gets completely demolished.
You know, that's a really good point.
When I go to a superhero movie now, I just want to see the exact same visuals that I see in every single other superhero movie. So, thumbs down, unsubscribed. this movie was great. This movie was fucking great. I actually really loved it. It was nice to see a movie that felt like the script came first. This is a really great, concise script with a lot of clarity to what was happening, and the characters drove the story, and it was wonderful.
That's right, Jay. It was great to see an X-Men film that utilized all the characters appropriately, where it seemed like each character had something important to do. Unlike the third one, and maybe First Class to a certain extent, but this one, and it followed through with all the proper X-Men themes.
Yes.
As opposed to just Wolverine needs to be a leader. The Xavier and Magneto ideals clashing against each other, human interference, all that stuff. Yeah. And it wasn't heavy-handed or stupid.
Yeah, I was hooked immediately because I'm a big fan of post-apocalyptic movies, and it's sort of interesting that it kind of in a way parallels the first X-Men movie, which starts with the concentration camp, and this is almost like a weird future version of that where you're seeing bodies just being dumped, and it's really dark and great.
And just all the cool exciting mutant action.
Mm-hmm. Right off the bat, in a way where people are using their powers to help one another, mm-hmm. and really good.
Yeah, because some of the earlier X-Men movies felt sort of cheap. in comparison to like the bigger Marvel movies.
Yeah.
But if I compare this to like the Avengers, I would say I like this more. Mm. There are two different types of movies. The Avengers is like an ensemble. It's almost a comedy.
It's Joss Whedon. It's witty. It's goofy. It's so lighthearted.
Right.
This feels like there's more at stake.
More at stake, and better use of the characters.
You'll need me as well. Side by side to end this war. Before it ever begins.
Now, comic book nerds, I mean fans, will probably complain that this story is Wolverine-centric and not Kitty Pryde-centric, because I guess the original comic, it was her that was doing the time traveling, because she phased throughout the time periods. And this one, somehow, she has the magical ability to shine blue light into Wolverine's head and transport his consciousness back in time.
Into himself in the past.
Yes. Which is fine, because in this movie, Wolverine works perfectly as the story catalyst.
Yeah.
He's just, it's almost like fish out of water in an action movie sort of way.
Yeah.
He's a dumb guy with claws who has to explain everything to young Professor Xavier and Magneto and kind of help them.
Yeah.
It's more of a story about those two. It's Wolverine himself, he's a neat character, but to me he's not totally interesting or fascinating.
He's Hugh Jackman. He has to be the center of every X-Men movie.
Sure, he makes a great Wolverine, but he's used perfectly in this because the movie's not about him.
Yeah.
He's just pushing the story along. And that's the proper use of the Wolverine character. It's more about the ideals of Magneto and Professor X and how, when dealt with the human situation, which is what the X-Men is about.
Yeah, well, and that lends itself to the Peter Dinklage character too, which is what I've always liked about these X-Men movies, is there's not villain of the week movies.
Yes.
And this one, Peter Dinklage is essentially the villain, but he doesn't have I want to kill all mutants. Like, he has his own ideals, and those clash of different perspectives that drives the story.
He's done his homework, he's researched the past and what's happened from, you know, Neanderthal to Cro-Magnon, and he sees it coming. And wants to save everyone. So there's nothing evil about that from his perspective. But it comes at a great cost, obviously.
Yes, and the moral of the story is, unless everyone gets along, we're all going to have a terrible apocalyptic future.
Which is probably true.
Yes.
Yeah.
All those years wasted fighting each other, Charles.
A lot of people die. Friends.
So this movie, Wolverine is in it quite a bit, as he is in all these X-Men movies, and also pushed to the forefront of this one is Mystique. I'm assuming that has to do with the fact that Jennifer Lawrence is now an Academy Award winning actress. She's okay as far as the character's use in the movie, but I don't like her in that role. I said this about American Hustle, is that she looks like a little kid playing dress up. Mm-hmm. She has like a cutesy kid face. I don't think she works for the Mystique part.
No.
Oh my god.
Oh my god.
Oh.
A beach ball. Hey,
look at that.
Oh no. It's a Grown Ups 2 beach ball. I can't in good conscience play with this beach ball, Jay.
Hey bro, what'd you do to my beach ball?
I'll throw this into the ocean. Then maybe a sea animal will choke on it. Then something good will come of Grown Ups too, finally. Seemed to just hit midair and fall.
That was bizarre.
Yeah, that was kind of bizarre. Were you a little worried just for the beginning a little? Like, my expectations were completely changed once I saw the whole movie. I was kind of picturing like this dark, kind of ugly future and this needlessly complicated plot and all this stuff. Because in the beginning, Xavier shows up and he just starts explaining everything that happened to everyone that already knows what happened. Like telling Wolverine what to do and all this stuff. And I said, what is all this exposition?
And Yeah. No, I wasn't worried up front because at the very beginning, I kind of felt like I was being dropped into the second part of a movie. It almost felt like there's a movie before this that we didn't see, because it's like the last X-Men movie was a prequel. The last X-Men, of the first three X-Men movies, obviously there's no leaning towards some sort of post-apocalyptic world. So I was like, we're right in the middle of this. So I didn't mind the exposition right up front, because it sort of reacquaints you with one of these characters, because we haven't seen some of these people in 10 years. Halle Berry shows up and says nothing for the first hour and a half of the movie, which is the perfect way to utilize Halle Berry in this role.
Does she say anything?
She has like two lines towards the end. She says something like, "Everyone get back." And that's her line. And that's the best way to utilize Halle Berry as Storm in these X-Men movies, because she's always been terrible. Well, I guess now we should get into spoilers. Do we want to talk about spoilers?
Sure.
Okay, we will talk about spoilers now.
Skip to this time code to learn what we thought of Seth MacFarlane's latest ball movement. And also his new movie, The Wild Wild West. Well, you talked about Mystique, them putting Jennifer Lawrence as a major character. That felt a little shoehorned, mainly because of her powers somehow made the Sentinels change, which seemed
her
more...
specific blood was important to make the Sentinels work, which was weird.
Well, no, her mutant powers didn't make the Sentinels work. They made them adapt and change, which seemed more like a Rogue thing, because that was very specifically Rogue's power plotline than a Mystique, because Mystique just changes appearance.
Yeah.
The Sentinels were actually changing powers to adapt to what the mutants were fighting them with, which didn't make any sense at all.
Because they're machines made of metal?
But for the logic of the movie, it made some sense, because they established Mystique as sort of like... she was sort of like the student that Magneto and Xavier were pulling in two different directions, and then it comes down to this morality lesson at the end.
And it's more character-driven. It doesn't have to make complete sense.
It doesn't make sense on the mutant level, but it makes sense on a character level, which I was okay with.
Yeah.
And, you know, she wasn't in the movie a ton. It was more, Magneto is really good in this.
Yes.
He turns super, super villain in it.
Yeah, Michael Fassbender and James McAvoy are both, because I love Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart in those roles, but those two do a really good job of capturing the spirit of those characters.
And there's a great sequence with the character Quicksilver.
Yes.
Did you enjoy that?
I thought that was one of the highlights of the movie, the sequence with Quicksilver, where we're seeing the world in his time. Mm-hmm. So everyone's, because he's very, very fast, so we're seeing it all in super, super slow-mo. As he's just a cocky teenager, and he's fucking with all these cops. Mm-hmm. And then, oh, they're shooting at my friends. Ding! It's great.
Can we comment on how this movie is so far superior to Spider-Man 2?
This is far superior to most summer movies. Like this, I felt like I was watching a real movie. I was invested in the story. I cared about the characters, and it never got horribly convoluted or messy. It wasn't, we want to do this action scene, we want to do this set piece. It was just a story, and the action sprung from that.
As far as like that dumb Spider-Man movie where it's just so much noise and junk, like, but this is ultimately more satisfying.
Oh, yeah.
I would say this is the best movie I've seen this summer, for sure.
By far.
Maybe in a while. Just because it was so neat. Especially the ending, when Magneto takes the stadium and drops it around the White House.
He was using his powers to do something interesting and clever.
Yes. Yes. As opposed to when he pointlessly moved the Golden Gate Bridge to connect to Alcatraz Island. And then somehow the Golden Gate Bridge miraculously stayed in place.
Yes.
Even though it would have instantly collapsed.
Charles always wanted to build bridges.
Can't say enough good things. Any bad things?
Richard Nixon. It's hard to put Richard Nixon in a movie without it seeming like a comical caricature, just because he had such a distinct personality. So the guy playing Richard Nixon, I suppose he did what he could, but it was distracting to me. But that's a very, very minor thing. Well, also speaking of presidents, then, the other thing that was a little groan-worthy was the JFK assassination stuff.
Yes.
Do you want to explain what that
was?
Well,
the movie starts off with Magneto's in a prison underneath the Pentagon, and he's been in prison for 10 years. It's 73, so in 63, he got arrested for trying to assassinate Kennedy by making the bullet move, which is the Kennedy assassination theories.
Yeah.
But he said he tried to make it move to save him because he was a mutant.
Well, what he specifically says is because he was one of us, which you could...
That means he's a mutant.
Well, no, they made it a little vaguer. It could be he's one of us as far as he is a mutant, or he's just a supporter of mutants.
A proponent of mutant.
It would have been worse if he just flat out said he was a mutant. So I think they tried to soften how goofy that was a little bit by just saying he was one of us. But yeah, that was the weakest part of the movie, that idea.
Yeah, it was a little groan-worthy, where he went, ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't say JFK was a mutant. Or maybe if he had a cool mutant power, it would be okay. No, he... That's why you're not on the show.
He had the mutant power to be able to satisfy Marilyn Monroe?
He had the mutant power of being a sleazy, womanizing politician that the public still loved.
That's the best mutant power of all.
He could also shoot porcupine needles out of his skin.
Do you think this movie could have used more Peter Dinklage?
I know you have a man crush on Peter Dinklage.
Well, this is the thing, yeah. You have a man crush on Bryan Cranston. I have a man crush on Peter Dinklage. I don't know what that says about me, but I think he's a very good actor. And I'm glad that now he's like a big movie star. And he's on Game of Thrones, and he's like an action guy, and people love him.
We've been given a second chance. Guide us. Lead us.
I don't want your future! Supposed to protect them.
It just feels richer, more realistic, more exciting. The other ones felt cheap.
Yeah.
This one, I think, should be popular with X-Men fans, other than just a little tweaks and...
They might complain about some of the differences in the story from the comics, but as a movie, it's... Yeah.
If you look at it overall, it has all the right themes. It's not a villain of the week. It's not a dumb, loud, Jamie Foxx is shooting electricity for no reason other than he's mad at Spider-Man. I'm mad at Spider-Man. There's an actual, like, a cool time travel plot, and I'm sure there's probably some contradictions in that, but who cares?
It's time travel. It's going to happen. It's basically the Terminator.
Yeah.
And I was okay with that. Yeah. It wasn't a trite ending where it's just the good guy has to stop the bad guy and save the girl. Like, right. there's ideas going on. Yeah. It's smart. It's well written.
Yeah.
And everybody is good in it.
Yeah. So, Jay, would you recommend X-Men Days of Future Pants?
Absolutely. I can't recommend it enough. It's the most entertaining movie I've seen, definitely this summer, maybe in multiple summers.
Yes, I agree. I would also definitely recommend X-Men Days of Future Pants. Did you see what I did there? I changed the word past to pants because they sound similar, making people think of what future pants might look like. I guess we all have future pants. They're pants we're going to wear tomorrow, and the next day, and the day after that.
Now you put that under your pillow and the tooth fairy will leave you a penny. There ain't no tooth fairy, idiot. Now clean up that horse shit.
Welcome everybody to the Wild Wild West.
The American frontier in 1882 is a terrible place in time.
Oh, hey, look, it's the ice. Why is it so big?
So it doesn't melt. It's actually really interesting how they do it.
That went south so fast!
A Million Ways to Die in the West is terrible. It stars a man who loves himself way too much, Charlize Theron, Liam Neeson, and Amanda Seyfried. Considering this was a Wild West film, it's ironic that we had more fun watching the tumbleweed rolling by us in the empty theater. Hey, that was a joke, McFarlane. That's how that's done.
What was the joke?
Mike, what did you think of a million ways to tell the same three jokes over and over again?
Well, Jay, I thought this movie sucked. It may have been the worst movie I've ever seen.
Oh, the new one?
This is actually probably true.
No.
You don't think so?
No.
Well, I wasn't expecting this to be as bad as it was. I don't hate Family Guy. A lot of people hate Family Guy. A lot of people love Family Guy.
Yes.
I'm kind of in the middle. I find it humorous at times. I've not followed it or watched it a lot. I enjoyed Ted a little bit. Mm. It had some funny stuff in it.
See, the thing about Ted, I don't think I laughed once during the entire movie, but it wasn't unpleasant to watch. Mm. Like, it was a very well-written comedy script from a structure point of view.
Yes, it was.
And it was such an odd little premise that it kind of propped the movie up from just being a generic comedy.
Yeah.
This movie has the most stale, lame script that you could possibly write.
Yeah.
It's for every one joke that's funny, there's like 15 that just fall completely flat.
Oh, and every funny joke is in the trailer.
Mm-hmm.
I have to say the premise, this is a movie that works as its trailer perfectly. I was like, oh, doesn't look that bad. Like the idea of making fun of the Old West with how everyone dies and being real cynical and kind of that whole concept was funny.
Yeah.
Rich thought that he time traveled because it was so like tongue in cheek.
Well, that's one of the three jokes in the movie is that he talks like a modern day person, but he's in the West.
Yes, yeah. That perspective is sort of amusing that everyone was miserable and everyone died horribly, and because that's kind of true.
Yeah.
But they didn't really do too much with that material. It became bogged down in this like love triangle plot.
Yeah.
That was really like, it was trying to be sweet and funny and it just ended up failing. Everything failed in this movie, almost everything.
Well, if there's a joke that Seth MacFarlane thinks is funny, he's gonna do it 5, 6, 7 more times. One of the only times I never laughed out loud, but I mildly chuckled a couple times. And one of them was early on, he's looking at pictures of him and his now ex-girlfriend, and it's just them standing there, and they make a mention of how nobody smiles in old photos. I was like, that's kind of funny. But then they bring that back like 5 times.
Yeah.
It's like, it was an amusing little one-off joke.
Although they twist it into a plot thing where he gives her a picture.
I know, but no.
I'm glad they explained that because I was sitting there thinking, I'm like, they didn't smile in old photos because it took like 4 minutes to expose film back then.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like, do they know that? Or are they just, and then they explain it,
mm-hmm.
that you have to actually stand there and hold a smile for a long time.
Yeah.
And that's why people didn't smile in old photographs. But I'm like, I hope they say something about that. They can't be that dumb. And then they did.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, well, you kind of defeated your own joke. Seth MacFarlane is a sheep farmer. And his girlfriend, played by Amanda Seyfried, doesn't really love him that much. He loves her, and then she leaves him for Neil Patrick Harris, who is a mustache connoisseur, owner of a mustache wax shop. He's the rich asshole guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then, for no reason, Charlize Theron wants to help Seth MacFarlane win back.
After meeting him for 5 minutes.
Win back his girlfriend by pretending to be his girlfriend. And surprise, surprise.
Where do you think this is going?
They fall in love in the process.
Yeah.
I'm his girlfriend. A lot of sexual activity.
All the time. I live inside her. So if you want to send me a letter, you got to address it care of her vagina.
Yep.
And then Liam Neeson's in the movie for 2 minutes as the main villain. And then there's filthy sex jokes with Sarah Silverman and Giovanni Ribisi for no reason other than to say fuck and asshole and cum.
Oh, that was a long day. This one man wanted me to smoke a cigar and then like ash on his balls while I'm jerking him off. And it was just like, what? Can I do this? But I did.
Wow.
Because aren't those words funny?
I'll give you a little tap on the hat when I'm good to go, okay?
There's so many, like, what? Is that supposed to be funny kind of moments?
Yeah, there's lots of dead silence in the theater.
Dead silence, and, well, we should mention that we saw this movie with about 15 or so elderly people?
There was a lot of old people in the theater. The only thing I can think of is that they heard Western.
Western and matinee pricing for seniors.
Okay.
They heard those two things. Western, unfortunately, I'm hoping they didn't think this was going to be a John Wayne film. Because John Wayne...
Wayne films are funnier than this.
Hey-o! That's pretty good. That's
okay,
pretty good.
Thank you. Well, the thing is, like, going back to talking about him acting like someone out of, you know, of modern times, I was picturing, like, a Woody Allen movie, and Woody Allen in that role, and I could see that working.
Yes.
Woody Allen all nebbish and, like, talking about everyone dying of diseases and getting shot or whatever, and that's funny because of his personality. Seth MacFarlane is so stiff in this movie.
Yes.
He should not be a leading man. It's clear that he thinks he is just like the comedy superstar right now.
I think what's more impressive, not that he does so much, is that he does all of it so well and so effortlessly. This is a guy who's at the top of his game right now, so.
And it's not warranted at all.
Yeah, there's a bit of I can't say for certain, but there's a bit of an ego thing that you get, a vibe that you get from him.
Mm-hmm. Well, especially with this movie. Like, oh, he has to choose between Amanda Seyfried and Charlize Theron.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you, Seth MacFarlane.
Is it possible that you are so cunning and so diabolical and so wealthy that you created this entire project just to be able to make out with Charlize Theron?
You know what?
Kudos and applause to all the hardworking craftspeople in the film industry. The animal handlers, the cinematographer, the cameraman, the sound department, really great looking scenery.
Sure.
Great looking shots. There's a wonderful shot where him and Charles Theron are riding horses and they got the sun setting, peeking out right beyond the thing. There's some really great like crane shots that are really nice looking. The sets, the costumes, all the things you take for granted in a movie. It's just unfortunate that the film was helmed and written by a talentless hack.
Yeah, all that work is in service of Neil Patrick Harris shitting in a hat.
But it is very, very silly and quite crude too.
Great focus. On all the images.
That's true. I don't think there was a single shot in this movie that was out of focus.
No. The sheep, how hard is it to get a sheep trainer?
I don't know.
Sheep are called sheep because they don't listen to you and they're dumb and they go around in a herd and don't do anything.
Mm.
It's hard to train a sheep. I'm not an animal expert, but I would imagine it's hard to train a sheep. Do you agree with me?
I have no idea. I don't know anything about sheep. I know they're not a good source of comedy in this film.
And they had some really clever puns that a five-year-old came up
with. A penny it is. Good Lord, Albert. You're such a sheepskate. Oh!
Hey, sheeper. I'm glad you showed up at the end after making a series of sheep puns earlier, right? And at the end he says, hey, sheeper, I'm glad you showed up. Shouldn't he have said, I'm glad you showed up. I thought you might be too sheepish.
Oh, yeah, that's...
They made six other sheep puns, but they didn't make that one, and he just calls him a sheeper.
Yeah. Christopher Lloyd shows up to make a Back to the Future 3 reference, because do you remember that? Do you remember that movie?
I remembered that he time traveled to Hill Valley, California, not Arizona.
And that doesn't matter. He was in the West. So you end your scene, Seth MacFarlane has a little romantic scene with Charlize Theron. He walks away, and then there's a barn, and there's light coming from the barn. So for no reason, he just walks up to it and opens it, and there's Doc Brown. And he says, what are you doing? And Doc Brown says, oh, it's a weather experiment. Mm-hmm. And then Seth MacFarlane says, okay, bye, and then he leaves, and that's the joke. Do you remember that?
I was happy to see Christopher Lloyd as Doc Brown again.
That would be nice if he had an actual joke to play off of. And that's what I really discovered with this movie, because I've always felt Seth MacFarlane relies on pop culture references for humor. They're not jokes, they're just references. That's most of what Family Guy is, and that's what that is. But because this is set in the West, there's not many opportunities to do that. So you really get a good feeling for the limited range of what types of jokes Seth MacFarlane can write. There's no pop culture references, so there's just anal sex jokes to replace it.
What is unique to Seth's type of humor?
That it's not one-dimensional. That it's not, you're... It's
the only sense that you get that has any familiarity with Westerns are references to Back to the Future 3 and Django Unchained. Like, this is clearly, like, you look at Blazing Saddles, like, Mel Brooks clearly has a love for Westerns. And this is, oh, he's seen some modern Westerns.
Yeah.
And so he made a movie based around that.
Do you remember the hilarious sequence when Seth MacFarlane is being chased by Liam Neeson on horseback? Liam Neeson and his whole gang of bad guys.
Oh, yeah.
And it has like 20 minutes of them riding, and I keep thinking, like, this is gonna go to some kind of great comedy setup or some joke, isn't it? And then we see a train, and I'm like, something funny's gonna happen. And then Seth MacFarlane jumps his horse in front of the train just in time, and all the bad guys are on the other side of the train.
Mm-hmm.
And then the train leaves, and we're like, where's he at? Something funny's gonna happen.
What's the punchline to this?
And then he somehow got on the train with the horse.
And then they just drive away on the train.
I escaped. And then it ended.
Maybe that was, he was gonna put a joke in there in the second draft that he never wrote.
He juggles a lot of balls and does it really effortlessly. No, he really juggles.
So many balls.
So there's a Ryan Reynolds cameo for no reason. He doesn't have any lines of dialogue. The Liam Neeson's in the bar. And he's looking for the man that kissed his wife, which is Charlize Theron. And he looks over, and there's Ryan Reynolds. And Ryan Reynolds goes, and then Liam Neeson shoots him. And that's his cameo.
Inside joke, some kind?
Why?
I couldn't tell you. I couldn't tell you.
Because random? I recognize him, so it's funny?
I thought the showdown was coming with Liam Neeson, and then he ends up on an Indian camp.
Yeah, and that gets dragged out forever.
Isn't it hilarious that Indians say things about drugs like stoners do?
Yeah.
It's funny because they're Indians.
Mm-hmm. Well, someone doing drugs is instantly funny, right? Just the idea that they're doing drugs, that's hysterical.
And Charlize Theron takes out a pot brownie mm-hmm. or a pot cookie, and then they eat it.
And then they eat it, and then they laugh.
This is a weed cookie, isn't it? You're no. Yes. No, I don't do well with that
cookie.
Stuff. No.
Come on, just a little
bit. No,
He wanted to have the Vision Quest scene, and needed to set it up.
Mm.
So he just wrote in a part where she takes out a pot cookie. Just to set up that he doesn't like drugs. And then,
yeah.
and then they have that bizarre, like, the Vision Quest sequence when he learns he has to be a man and kill the bad guy, which is pretty self-explanatory.
From director Seth MacFarlane, who brought you Ted.
There are a million ways to die in the West.
Comes the smartest.
Hola a todos mis amigos, yo soy María Salas desde el Festival de Cine de Toronto en Canadá. Me encuentro con la famosa actriz y cantante Selena Gomez.
One thing that I did find was amusing was when a big bar fight breaks out in the bar, of course,
mm-hmm.
and him and Giovanni Ribisi have a plan to pretend to fight.
Oh, sure.
Little moments like that.
There's a couple ideas that are funny in theory, but not necessarily in execution.
Shit. Ouch! That came out of my penis!
I would like to welcome a new member to our community.
Welcome to our awesome town.
What's with this fair?
Every year, people die.
Really?
Everybody hold still.
People die at the fair.
People die at the fair.
Jay, would you recommend A Million Ways to Not Watch This Movie?
If you're talking about the act of A Million Ways to Not Watch This Movie, then yes.
Hmm.
If you're just using that as an alternate title for the film, A Million Ways to Die in the West, then no, I would not recommend it. It was kind of horrible.
Yeah.
Wow, you look amazing.
I really love that the most alluring fashion today is to simulate a fat ass.
If I was a black guy, this is the meanest trick you could play on me.
All I know is that the actor who played Mr. Belding from Saved by the Bell needs a million ways to diet in the West. And that's all I got, folks. Thank you. I am Seth MacFarlane.
A Million Ways to Die in the West.
Where do you go?
You know, Jay, it sure is great being away from the VCR repair shop and our miserable lives.
That's right, Mike. What do you say we go hit up the beach? Spring break! You okay?
Yeah, I'm all right. Yeah. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
I know.
None of it was real, was it?
Oh.
All we have is terrible movies, Jay.